Hi.
Hello, mate. You like fish?
So what have we got?
So I thought we'd do a sashimi salad, slightly plagiarised from where I did my training.
No boo.
Correct. Normally, it's you interviewing all the sports people and business people and all that sort of stuff, and now you can just sit back and relax and I can find out really what is happening at Charles Tirrett. Is that, that's the idea.
Charles Tirrett post-coronavirus. We suddenly woke up one day and nobody was buying shirts.
You're the largest online...
I've been doing it for about 150 years and everyone's always bought shirts.
Yeah.
And suddenly they just stopped. You know, literally people were wearing pyjamas, T-shirts, including you. Bloody disgrace. I mean, you nearly killed me. You nearly killed my business. And we had to change the business. I did actually go bust in 1994, and it was something I always thought, I'm not going to do that again.
Yeah.
But coronavirus came along, we very nearly went bust again. I think a lot of businesses tended to either do really well or really badly. And I think our sector was just really badly hit, and some of our competitors did go bust.
That was going to be a question. I mean, I've read about them.
Yeah.
What do you think there was that difference?
I think the difference was, I'm a bit sort of old and boring, so we've never really had any debt in the business. And I think if you had debt during coronavirus and your market stopped, then the banks got very twitchy very quickly.
Right, well, should we chop first?
So I've cut down and then I'm going to cut across. That basically makes it really small and then you can chop.
Quite similar to making a shirt.
Is it?
Yeah. Stitching, very detailed. Do I have to have a go now?
Well, I want you to concentrate.
Should I do smaller? Oh, God, okay.
I mean, I thought we were going to get through this dish pretty quickly, but actually...
Yeah, no, here we go. Come on, I'm going to speed up.
I did want to ask a question about Chrissy.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
How competitive does it get? You're both incredibly successful.
Why would it be
similar industries. Do you know what I've got in my mind? No trading places with the brothers at trading places.
Yeah,
Well, they just have a bet on
with a dollar.
Yeah, with a dollar.
A dollar in the loo. One of the things about being an entrepreneur is that it can be, you know, it can be quite lonely, basically. You don't trust me with a knife.
No, I do trust you with a knife. I might get you.
Are mine as good as yours?
They are. See, look,
you can't tell the
difference. You just can't tell the difference there.
And also, it's quite tough putting all. You have all your eggs in one basket. So you have one business, and if it goes bust, then that's it. You know, you're finished. One of the great things about having both of us having our own businesses, you need to take risk as an entrepreneur. It needs to be calculated risk. And I think when you know you have a bit of a fallback, so I effectively sort of had the white company unless she booted me out and she had Charles Tirrett. You can take more risks and you can grow the business a bit faster. And there've been times over the years when I've been doing well and she's been not doing well, and then when she's doing well, I've not been doing well. And it actually works, so it works really well. I like to take the credit for the white company.
Do you know what I love about this? I love the fact that you're mentioning it, all of this, and she's not here.
You know, if she was here, I certainly wouldn't say it.
Yeah, exactly right.
So I will never let her listen to this, but we went away on holiday when I started the shirt business. I spent the whole week saying, look, I'm really sorry, but I want to go back to my little business, because that's the great thing about having your own business. You know, you do it. You feel so passionate about it.
Go on.
Are you going to do another? Keep
going. Yeah, go on.
You feel so passionate about it. I didn't want to go on holiday. So I spent the whole week saying, I want to go back to my business. She spent the whole week saying, well, I'm a normal person and I like being on holiday. You know, don't be ridiculous. When we got back, she said, actually, I think I want to have my own business too. So I said, well, if I can do mail order, you know, anybody can do mail order, you know, even you. And then she said, well, what can I do? And we went to stay with my sister, who just bought a house, and she couldn't find good quality white cotton sheets. And I said to Chrissy, why don't you do white cotton sheets? And I remember thinking, I mean, at the time, I thought, the only thing I wanted is that her business would never be more successful than my business. So I thought sheets seemed like a pretty stupid idea. But as long as it was a stupid idea, that was fine by me. So she knew nothing about sheets. And actually, I mean, it was the best business decision of my life. I gave her £5,000 for 25% of the business. So that was the sort of... That was the best business decision of my life.
I'm going to sieve them to take the acidity off the onion.
And then dry them.
Just dry them very quickly, yeah. That's by far the most complicated bit.
That was quite hard.
I need you to put some soy sauce in there, please.
Was that carefully measured?
Yeah, I'd say that's about a cup.
That's a cup. A big cup.
Right, a bit of mustard. English mustard in a Japanese dish. I know that sounds a little bit crazy.
Rice wine vinegar.
Sesame seed oil.
Some grapeseed oil, and probably about the same.
Dab of water in there as well. Okay, right, give that a mix up for me. Right, have a little taste, sir.
So this is just going to taste like a bit of soy, with a bit of mustard and a bit of...
Tell me what you think. I mean, you're going to be eating it, so you need to tell me what it's like.
Mm, it's rather good, actually.
Yeah?
God knows where this meant to taste like, though.
Salty.
Mmm! Oh, that's good. Now, we're going to put the onions in. Again, got to have a taste. Hold on.
It tastes the same.
Hold on.
Same spoon?
No double dipping, please.
No double dipping.
Goodness me.
This is going to taste the same with a bit of onion in.
Oh, it's just, you know, honestly.
Raw onion.
Yeah? Good.
Dine and gone to heaven.
Right, we need some pepper in there.
Well, they've got the sugar there.
Oh, what we're talking about, yeah, put some sugar in. That's enough. We just need to prep the fish.
Yeah.
And we're going to very, very quickly...
Pan fry.
..the fish.
Yeah.
And then we're pretty much set to put the dish together.
Yeah, it's easy.
I mean, it is pretty easy, to be honest. A lovely loin of tuna. I want you to crack a load of pepper onto the plate. And whilst you're doing that, you've got to tell me how the partnership with the RFU is going.
It's really good, actually. I mean, I think it's a great, is that enough?
Go on, you carry on talking.
Oh, you're a bit quicker than me. It's a fantastic link, I think, with the RFU. It's sort of shared values. I mean, I was a rugby player. I was actually not very good. I just happened to be in the right place at the right time, and everybody stopped playing, and I became captain. And we lost every single game I played. So that was sort of, I was a great leader.
Consistent, though?
Consistent, yeah. It was consistently bad.
Yep.
Despite losing every game, I've always loved rugby. And I think it's the sort of sport that the Charles Tyrwhitt customer really loves. Well, first of all, it's about the white shirt. I mean, I think you remember the day you pulled on the white shirt for the first time, and that must be quite a feeling.
Crazy.
Charles Tyrwhitt customers get exactly the same feeling every single day when they pull on that Charles Tyrwhitt white shirt.
And there's nothing quite as good, though, is there, of like you're opening a new shirt.
Yeah, I know, crisp cotton shirt.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I know.
Crisp, and it's, yeah.
And the white shirt is a real signature for us. I mean, I think we do, you know, popped in through the twill, all the different fabrics, and then evening shirts and collarless shirts and linen shirts. And, you know, it's a sort of, I mean, there are 18 white shirts. It's similar values. You know, when I go to Twickenham, it's a fun experience. You know, you're sitting with the opposition fans, everyone's having a good time. It's teamwork, working together. It's
like discipline, passion, culture. But in sport, you know, you can build towards that game at the weekend. At some stage, you're going to use those values in a meeting, in training, or in the build up to the game. You've got the crowd, and it's easy to take a breath and think, yeah, I am wearing the white shirt, and I am going to be passionate, and I am going to do it for my teammates.
Yeah.
How on earth do you instill those values day in, day out, across the world with 700 plus staff?
You need to have some sort of levels in a business. But I always like to think of the business as being the idea that everybody is equal, but everybody is at a different stage of their careers. So we get people who come in right at the beginning. If we've chosen the right people, the people who come into Charles Tyrwhitt at the beginning will be the people who will be, you know, running, you know, the big retail businesses in 20 years' time. One of the few jobs I had was I worked at Harrods. I left school, I was going on a year off, I needed some money, and they put me in the golfwear department. And at the end of day one, I said to him, look, I know you've been running this department for 20 years, because you've told me so many times, you know, it's fine. But I've got a list here of 10 things that I think you could do that would make this golfwear department a better department. Now, I thought I was being really quite clever. And I thought, you know, possibly even promotion day two. I mean, I was getting optimistic. And so when I came in on the second day and found myself in luggage, the guy got rid of me. I thought, hang on a minute, there's something wrong here. Okay, I was being a little bit, probably a bit arrogant,
yeah,
a bit pushy. He thought, I've been running this for 20 years. This guy's just left school. He thinks he knows about retail. He doesn't, and I didn't. But I think everybody, you know, whatever stage they're at, and they all have a different view about what's right and wrong. And some of those things will be right, and some of them will be wrong. You know, after that Harrods thing, I said, right, I know I'm going to have my own business. And when I have my own business, I want to have a business that doesn't work like Harrods. It doesn't work where people say, right, well, I've been doing it for 20 years, so therefore I know how to do it best.
Yeah.
I want a business where, you know, you come in and you say, if this was my business, what would I do? So it's sort of trying to get a business where people, you know, can make a difference.
What, I'm just going to get you to...
Oh, to flip it around.
And just roll it within all just angles. There, I'll give you a bit more.
Oh, God, I've got put too much on
my side. No, no, you're okay, don't worry. What year was this?
That was in 1983.
Right. The reason why I ask that is that in rugby, in the early 90s,
yeah,
it was very hierarchical. So you had players that had been in for, you know, 7, 8, 9 years, all the household names,
yeah,
and very rarely would a 20-year-old come in and be in the squad. And if they would, they would just get told to
clean the boots.
Do as I'm told, clean the boots. That apprentice, yeah, you know, apprentice type feel. When Clive Woodward came in and you had Lawrence was captain, then Jono was captain, then I was captain for a season, yeah, and a lot of youngsters came through, Mike Tindall's, Ian Balshaw, Matt Perry, Johnny Wilkinson. And that was absolutely one of the significant changes within the dynamics of the team, was that it just didn't matter how old they were.
But who made the change? Who decided that's how it worked? Was it just
it was down to Clive.
It was down to Clive.
It was down to Clive. It had a very much an open-minded policy on who has the ideas. Because the theory being... is exactly as you say. We're going out on the field here to play a game. It doesn't matter who comes up with the idea to win.
Yeah.
If you're coming up with something different and you're a 20-year-old and you've thought of something different because what you were doing at school,
yeah,
we couldn't get monkeys, so long as it meant that we were winning.
It's that open-minded thing, isn't it? Some people think they're always right.
Yeah.
It's the same. Somebody comes along and says, well, why are you doing it like this? And I sort of say, Jesus, I mean, I've been doing it for 20, 30 years, and it's stupid. Why are we doing it like that? Why are we doing it like that?
Yeah.
You've got to be open-minded. You've always got to be open-minded. I mean, it's Clive Woodward's great sort of marginal gains. I mean, a few Dave Brailsford. I mean,
same.
People sort of say, wow, you know, you've been clever to build this business. It's not being clever. It's just starting with a simple idea and every day trying to do a little thing a little bit better.
I think you slightly underestimate how difficult that is, though. Every single day.
Realistically.
But you do, though, subconsciously.
Does my oven work?
We're gonna crank the oven up. Do you have to roll it or something?
You have to have very delicate fingers.
Go on then.
Let me have a go.
Go on then. Roll it. We're gonna roll that up to. Oh yeah.
There we go.
Very difficult. Look at that. The old wedding finger just rolled it through. Wedding.
8's hot enough, isn't it?
Well, yeah. I prefer 9, but.
Don't want to have a go again.
I mean, people are going to... This is the bit, unfortunately.
This is what I hate. No, I refuse to have this oven
they're
again.
They're going to use on some of the clips where we're clowning about.
Jesus.
Looking like we can't eat.
There we go.
Put a cooker on. They won't be worried about the food. This is the bit they're going to be using.
No oil or anything. We're going to get that pan super, 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 super hot.
Yep.
And then, using these tongs, not your fingers, we're going to bang it in there for probably... 10 seconds.
Each side.
Each side.
Yeah.
Okay, we're gonna go. Use this.
Yeah, off they come.
10 seconds, we'll get, flip it over, get it all the edges down, 10 seconds, then we're gonna flip it onto its side for 10 seconds.
Oh, okay.
And then when you've done that, bang!
In the ice.
You're gonna get it in the ice.
Does everyone know this trick?
Cool. Now what the ice does is, absolutely stops the cooking straight away because there's no margin for error. You want to stop the cooking straight away so it doesn't bleed through into the pink. So then when we slice through it, you're going to get this lovely pink and then a sharp edge around that you would have seen from
Same for the salmon?
Same for the salmon. Straight into the water. Don't worry, that's fine, that's fine. Thin as you feel comfortable, so it's one stroke and down.
Small slabs. 10 years training to do this?
10 minutes, did you say?
10 years.
Oh, 10 years.
10 years.
I've put some dressing on the leaves. Is it looking a little bit more like it?
Yeah, it looks good, it looks good.
Yeah? You know, you can like feed it around. Yeah, there you go. Yes, yes.
Work of art. I mean, just incredible, isn't it?
Et voilà. Gosh,
we do a high five. You're not allowed to do that.
Of course we are. Yeah. You know, I feel like there's a little part of me, you know, into the Charles Tyrwhitt family.
I know, it's
great. Really interesting to see, you know, how it's all pieced together and, you know, it's not just informative to the people that love Charles Tyrwhitt, but, you know.
Well, I really like having another rugby player in the in the company.
Two rocket stars.
Two of us now.
Ambassador and an owner.
Two of us now,
that's,
yeah.
That's quite nice.
Yeah, a couple of prop forwards.
Well, yeah, we're getting there. That is the hero shot, as they would say in food cooking.
It's extremely good, actually. I mean, Nobu could not do that any better. Where did the salmon... That salmon must have been straight out of the Atlantic this morning.
It just melts in your mouth.
Melts in your mouth. That is good. Can I finish it?
Go for it.
You're not aiming anymore.
Oh, I am.